Hello everybody, and welcome to the Reprieve Media CIC double handful coverage of the 2020 Cheltenham Festival. Yes folks, this will be the third Cheltenham Festival that we've managed to bring you our own views. Myself, Paul Newman, is here, and also on the line now we should have Steve Allpress. Steve, are you there sir? Welcome if you are.
Yes Paul, I'm here. Thanks for having me once again. I'm looking forward to it. Another fantastic week of racing.
Absolutely, sir. And it should be a festival of racing, shouldn't it? There really is no other word for it. I mean, we're gonna crack on this year. Are you going this year, sir, before we start? Are you planning on attending the festival this year?
Yes, I'll be making the trip to Cheltenham on Wednesday for the Champion Chase. I'm usually one for going on the first day. The first day is usually the day I prefer to go. Obviously, you have all them grade ones kicking off the meeting. But this year, just because Altior alone, I just want to go on the Wednesday and watch the Champion Chase, which I think we all know is going to be an intriguing spectacle between three of the jumping stars. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to it, mate. But, yeah, it'll be Wednesday this year for me.
Have you ever watched the Champion Chase live? Have you ever been on the Wednesday before, sir?
Yeah, I've been. I went a few years ago when Sprinter Sacra won his first Champion Chase when he beat CIC in Europe. Again, that was a brilliant day that day. Lovely weather that day as well. You know, you don't always get the best of weather at Cheltenham, but that day was actually, you know, a proper spring day. But yeah, I don't tend to go on the Wednesday much. I think the only other time I've been on the Wednesday was 2005, I think it was, when Moscow Flyer won the Champion Chase, beating Azerty up in World Chief. So, yeah, you know, I've seen some good ones when I have gone on the Wednesday. But, yeah, usually it's to Tuesday for me.
Yeah, you're not wrong, mate. You like to go, don't you? You like to go and watch your equine superstars. Brilliant. Right, we're going to crack on now then with the first day. As you said, there's some cracking action. And we're going to start with just what are your views on the Supreme Novices Hurdle this year, sir? And then I will mention a couple that I think are worth a mention, and then we'll move on to the Arkle. What have you got for the Supreme, sir?
We've got many horses in this lineup that I think you can certainly make consideration for. I think, you know, you have these horses that go through the season unbeaten, and I think this Supreme Novices is the first time, really, that they're put to the ultimate test. And looking through the race, you know, there's four or five that you could easily consider, but I've obviously narrowed it down to a couple that I like in the race. And the first one's the Nicky Anderson Franciszkin, Huntingdon last time. He fell earlier in the season, but visually he's always looked a nice imposing horse. Smooth traveller, and I think he'll play a big hand in this race. Obviously, the owners have another horse in the race, the Willie Mullins trained Asterion Falange. Him I'm not so keen on. I watched him at Leopardstown last time, and for me, he looks, just visually to me, looks like he needs a little bit further in trip, and I wasn't too keen on him jumping out to the right, so that would be a put off for me with him. But yeah, Shishkin would certainly be my number one. And the other horse that I like the look of is the Jigginstown horse trained by Gordon Elliott, Abacadabras. We saw him race against Envoy Allen earlier in the season at Fairy House, I think it was, and you know, he looks like he's got a big chance. He looks more of a speedy type to me. He travels well, and he'll be suited by a fast pace. He wouldn't want the ground to be too soft, but he'll certainly go there with a chance for sure. But yeah, you know, as I said, as I've already said, there's a few in there that you could also consider. Chantry House, the Nicky Anderson horse, and I know, I think it's Colin Tizard's Fiddle on the Roof that's in there that many like. But yeah, for me, mate, it's Shishkin and Abracadabras. But you know, like always, this Supreme's full of horses with a lot of potential, and you know, this is the first time really that I'll be there. The gun will be put to their head, and we'll find out tomorrow where they all lie, you know, in terms of going forward for like next year and that.
Yeah, I mean, like you, I think it's a fascinating race this year. Every year it is an interesting race every year. You normally get something that comes out of it. Normally it might not always necessarily be the winner as well. It's one of them sort of races. But for me this year, I've started to watch a few more novice hurdlers this year, and I'm not sure where I stand with a lot of them, because I realised quite early on in the season that I'd set my benchmark for looking at these things a bit too high, possibly. Time will tell over the next few months, but there's only one really that I have identified that I think is capable of winning this race, and that would be Shishkin. I mean, to me, you mentioned how visually impressive he was when he won the Sydney Banks Novice Hurdle at Huntingdon, a race Nicky Henderson does like to win with decent horses. So, to me, he must hold every chance here, especially when people look at his pedigree as well, because he's a very well-bred horse. I mean, I'm sure you remember this one. I know I do. He's, in fact, a half-sister to a Group 1, Triple Group 2, Triple Group 3, and four-time listed winning hurdler, a dam called Volaire Levedette. Do you remember that one?
Yes, I do. I think, she was runner-up to Big Bucks as well in one of his World Hurdle victories. Yeah, obviously, she was a very good, very good mare.
There you go. Shishkin is a half-brother to that. And he's also a half-brother to a horse I do remember quite fondly, actually, because it's an old Malcolm Denmark horse. He used to be trained by Carl Llewellyn, called Hennessy, a National Hunt chase horse. He actually won a Grade 3, was fourth in a Grade 2. And also the unraced dam of a horse that was fifth in the Grade 1 at Aintree last year, called a Goodbye Bobby. Twisting Davis trains that one. All out of a twice-raced second dam. And there's not, you know, Raise Your Heart is in there, a horse that won on the flat for Willie Mullins. And also Bolino Star, a Group 1 placed Group 2 winning hurdler. That is a nice horse, Shishkin. To me, it's a chaser, really. You look at that with Hennessy in there and Volaire Levedette. I mean, this horse, coupled to what you saw with your own eyes at Huntingdon, I mean, the horse has got the potential to be top class, hasn't it?
Yeah, definitely. As you say, the horse has got a lovely pedigree, and, it's plenty of scope looking at the horse, and it certainly looks like it'll be one that will... won't have any trouble jumping a fence like further down the line, whether that'll be next season or the season after. I guess only time will tell. I'd imagine they'll see what happens tomorrow and they'll make a decision from then on, really. But, you know, it was impressive at Huntingdon last time, and even the time before. I know on its first hurdling start, it did fall in the race, but I think it was a little bit unsighted there at one of the flights. So I think you can excuse that fall, but then next time at Newbury, even though it was still quite visibly, it was still green. I think it was very impressive the way it took off from the back of the last to the line. And I think all the signs are there just to show that this horse is top class and going forward. It's just how good is it? We'll find out tomorrow. But it certainly looks like it's got maximum potential.
You say how good is it? That's a good question, because if you look at the ratings of the horses running at Shishkin's race, they're about to 150-odd now RPR. If you look at over hurdles, if you look at the RPR with Volaire Levedette, she was in the 160s. And Hennessy is 150 chaser, you know. So this horse has also, I think, got more to come. What you've seen before could only be scratching the surface of this horse. It could have a lot of improvement left in it yet on only, what, its fourth run? Over hurdles, you know, fascinating prospect, Shishkin, for me. And what a horse to have going into bat for you for the first race of the festival. I mean, I don't think I've ever been as confident myself, personally, but there you go. What about the Arkle, sir? What have you got for the Arkle? What do you fancy in that race, sir, this year?
The Arkle's one of these races. I'm always intrigued to watch the Arkle. I really like this kind of race, and this year I'm a little bit stumped on it, if I'm to be totally honest with you. I've had a good look at the horses, and you know, I've watched them throughout the season, and I'm still not sure myself how this is going to play out, but one thing I do know is there's plenty of pace in this race, and we've got horses in here that, you know, they've been running from the front all season. Like, you've got the likes of Global Citizen that usually goes from the front. You've got Notebook that runs from the front. Fakadu Derry, that goes from the front. you know, so there's going to be a lot of pace in this race. So I'm just wondering, will this pace set something up for something coming off it? Like, just going on this season alone, on what I've seen, I would probably go for Notebook and Cashback. I'd go for both of them, just based on the Leopardstown run last time, because visually it looked to be a good race to me. But yeah, going into the race to tomorrow, I would worry that these horses up front are going to cut each other's throats and leave it open to something coming off the pace, like brewing up a storm or something. Again, I don't think it's the hottest Arkle we've seen in recent years, but it's a competitive one. And, I think you can make a case for five or six of these. But again, my selections wouldn't be a confident one, just more hopeful than anything.
And that would be Notebook, yeah?
Yeah. Notebook just over Cashback. I think Cashback's a good horse, but I'd have to just have Notebook slightly over him.
Okay, sir, fantastic. Me, I've had a look at a lot of novice races, like I said, and a lot of chases. What I did is I set my benchmark the same as for hurdles as at chasers. So I've got a lot more. I've looked at a lot more novice chasers than I have novice hurdlers, to be honest. And so as a consequence of that, I've got a few. I've got three that have managed to be identified by me and have made their way to this race. The first one you've already mentioned, he'd probably be the one I'd fancy the most, is Cashback. Like you said, he's my type of chaser. He's a bold front-running chaser, likes to get out in front. His jumping seems fairly sound as well. You know, he don't really make many mistakes. He's also quite a well-bred horse as well. He's a full brother to a horse that won a Group 1 in 2018 called Draconian. Willie Mullins, I think, trained it, or Gordon Elliott. You know, and the dam is half sister to Benefique. And she is the dam of a lot of decent French horses. Bebe Star that won a Grade 2, listed winning chaser called Bebe d'Or. You know, there's some nice horses in there. So I think Cashback might give a bold account. I think you get a good run for your money on Cashback. You'll try and lead. He'll be up there, and I think you'll get a good exciting run. And so another one that I think is heading the right way is Rouge Vif. You know, that's an interesting one, that. His hurdles form's good. He's Group 1 placed over hurdles at Aintree last year. He's a full brother to horse that was placed over hurdles in listed race. And also Rue the Noirs. I remember that one. It was a dam. Munir and Swede owned that one. And a Grade 2 placed hurdler in France as well, called Robin Dubois. So that one is not without hope, I don't think. And also my old mate, who I did predict last year would end up in the Ark, who he has done. He's a global citizen. I'd be a lot more confident if this race was at Kempton. It isn't. He's a nicely bred horse, you know. He's bred to a hairbreadth related to that, and to Plotting Shed of Henry Bronner Hebbs. Two solid horses at this level. Grade 2, Grade 3 level. I think, I don't know, he might fall a little bit short round Cheltenham. He has done in the past, the old boy. But for me, I think, like you said, sir, it's a tricky race. You know, like you said, there's a few in there. I never like to see a big field in the Ark. All novice chasers running fast. The scope for fallers here, I think, is quite bad. You know, I think there might be a few. I don't think a lot of these. I can see the race being quite eventful, a bit like last year when Kalashnikov was brought down. Anything could happen in this race, I think, sir. But yeah, I wouldn't put anyone off them three. And you said Cashback and Notebook for you, sir. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Fantastic. Right, we'll be back shortly with our thoughts on the final two group races of the day, the Champion Hurdle and the Mayor's Hurdle. But for now, thank you very much for listening, and all the best. Do you like what you're listening to on Reprieve Media CIC? If you do, there are plenty of ways that you can support us as we continue. You can donate to the Reprieve Media CIC PayPal account. To do that, please head to our website where you will see a donate tab on the side of the site. Also, Reprieve Media CIC is now on Patreon. Why not head over there now and check out our page? Just search for Reprieve Media CIC on Patreon. Thank you very much for your support, people. And you are listening to Reprieve Media CIC.
Whoa! Look how much saturated fat is in these chocolate biscuits. It's surprising how much is in our food and drinks. For us kids, eating too much saturated fat can lead to harmful fat building up inside, which we can't see, increasing the risk of heart disease or stroke when we get older. So be food smart. Download the free Change for Life food scanner app and start making healthier choices today.
We are looking to do now is Double Handful, the horse racing podcast. You've obviously heard some of the audio, the articles are going quite well, but it's really just myself at the moment. So I am looking for a lot more help with the Double Handful side. We are always looking for other people to get involved with the Double Handful project. Really, we're looking at the moment for maybe article writers or co-hosts even. Basically, we'll just talk about racing, talk about anything that interests us in the racing sector. You can have your own voice, and you will be giving your own opinions live on air about the pastime you love. If that is something that interests you, then get in touch. The email address is info@reprievemediacic.epz.com. Say that once more, info@reprievemediacic.epz.com. Hello everybody and welcome back to the coverage of Reprieve Media CIC Double Handful at the 2020 Cheltenham Festival. Before we crack on with the final two group races of day one, we'll just make sure that our co-host is still there on the line, Steve Allpress. Steve, are you there, sir?
Yes, I'm still here, Paul.
Fantastic. Can I just take this opportunity to say thank you very much for taking the time to make yourself available. We know you've got a lot on. It is very much appreciated. Right, sir. The flagship race of the first day, the champion hurdle. To be honest, like I said earlier, I've sort of rebooted mine. I'm looking at novices. Next year is really this time for me. I've seen with my own eyes, though, all the trials and that, all the races. But what are your views on this race, sir? I imagine your view will be considerably stronger than mine in this race, hopefully.
Well, obviously, looking through this year's champion hurdle, I think... You'd probably agree that it doesn't look the strongest from you on paper. However, you know, something's got to win the race. So, for me, this is the race where we're going to have to concentrate on the Nicky Anderson trained Epitant. I think you'll remember from last year that she was one of my strong fancies for the mare's novice. And obviously she ran very disappointing on the day. There's still questions out there to whether it come down to the track being against her or whether it was the flu vaccination prior to the festival or whether it was the headgear put on the horse or whether it was just something else. However, since then, the mare's had two runs this season. She's been visually impressive both times. And I think on that basis, you'd have to have her at the top of your pecking order for this race. She jumps well. She's a strong traveller. And also, one of the keys is she's getting the weight allowance here. So I think you have to put her down as a strong contender for this race. You know, several other horses in this race. But I think looking through the form, I think Epitant is the main one from the yard. You know, a couple of horses maybe for each way money. Maybe last year's Triumph Hurdle winner, Pentland Hills, been a little bit disappointing this season, not finishing off his race as well after travelling smoothly throughout. However, he's had a breathing operation since, and I feel he'll be a contender in tomorrow's race. Whether he's good enough, I'm not sure, but I certainly would put him down as an each way chance. One of the other horses at quite a big price I'd like is the Gavin Cromwell trained Darva Star. It finished second in the Irish Champion Hurdle to Honeysuckle last time at Leopardstown. It's an improving horse. I think it's 8 years of age, so it's not. I wouldn't say it's a young horse, but it is improving. And Gavin Cromwell, obviously, he was the winning trainer of the race last year, and I think he likes this horse, and he feels himself it's got a good each way chance. So they're the three I like, but Epitant would be my main fancy. She was disappointing, as I said last year, but I think she deserves another chance. I know your connections rate her highly, but I think until she runs tomorrow, we won't really know whether it was the track or something else that was wrong with her. But she's a good mare, and I think she'll go close.
I mean, yeah. You mentioned that the form of the mare this year, Epitant, and you have to say that she has made a mockery, an absolute mockery of that run she put in last year at the Cheltenham Festival this year. She looks a superb jumper of a hurdle. She doesn't lose any ground throughout the race over the obstacles. She's professional. Connections seem to have a lot of confidence behind her as well. The owner, J.P. McManus, renowned gambler. It's worth saying, it's worth pointing out that he is a renowned gambler, this man. So obviously any market support on the day, considerable market support. I mean, I think the horse was about 6-1 the night before the race. I think it went off something like the 2-1 favourite. And it never looked like losing that day. It absolutely cruised up and off it went, and it beat an average bunch of hurdlers. But it's racing an average bunch of hurdlers again tomorrow. You know, I can't see if there is as much confidence behind it tomorrow as there was last time that it's going to be a fearsome proposition on the day, I think. Hopefully there is no track issues. These things can happen, horses for courses. The opposite is also true. Horses hate courses as well sometimes. Whereas the opposite wouldn't be true. So, to me, if she can prove that the race last year was a one-off around that track, she's going to take a hell of a lot of beating, I think, tomorrow, personally. One I always chuck in this race is Super Sunday. You know, and I know you have your views on the horse. They've been well documented in previous years. We're not going to talk again about them here, but I like the horse. It's a beautifully well-bred horse. It's not really... Is its best form behind it? Probably so. but it does like the track. It's well bred. But to me, it's a race this year that is at the mercy of the favourite. And I'd like to see it oblige, really. I have you on because you know what you're on about, sir. And last year you were very strong on this horse, which indicates to me two things. One, that it's a good horse. And two, that it's a good horse. So it'd be nice for people to get rewarded on the horse. You know, they've shown a lot of patience over the year. You know, they've waited for this day. And I hope it proves you right, sir, the horse, really, on the day. That's my view on this race.
Yeah, you're right, mate.
So are you going to... What about the Mare's Hurdle, then? You ready to do the last Group 1 race of the day, the Mare's Hurdle?
Yeah, I'll do the Mare's Hurdle, mate.
Okay, sir. Right, so I know this race is a race you like. You know, it's a race that's rewarded you in the past. So I imagine it's a race that you look at more often than others. So what are your views on this year, sir?
Well, as you mentioned, it is a race that's rewarded me very well in the past, you know, mainly down to Willie Mullins. But yeah, going into this year's race, I think if I'm right in saying this, it's one of the smallest field mare's hurdles at the Cheltenham Festival I've seen. I don't ever recall the field being as small as this, and it's a pretty strong and select one too. You know, last year I was pretty sweet on Benny Deju in this race, and obviously a form leading up to the race was very strong, and she hasn't done much this year either. I'm actually going to go against her tomorrow with the Henry de Bromhead Honeysuckle. Again, I think it's a pick'em race. I certainly think the race is between the two mares. But I'm just going for Honeysuckle, just on the basis that she's several years younger than Benny Deju. And I just feel she's open to that little bit more improvement. I must say, I was very, very visually impressed with her at Fairy House earlier in the season. And from that moment, I've had this thought in the back of my mind that this race tomorrow is the race for her. Obviously, it's not going to be an easy task against the Willie Mullins mare. But you have to go with one. And I just feel that Honeysuckle will put it up to her tomorrow. I think the ground will benefit both mares. So I don't think the softer surface will inconvenience any of them, really. But I've just got this opinion that Honeysuckle might just have a little bit more tactical speed. And I think she'll just maybe a little bit too good on the day. I think they've made the right decision here, Connections, going for the mares over the champion hurdle, because I feel the 2 miles might have been a little bit sharp for her. So I think they have chosen the right race. But obviously, it's still going to be a tough ask to beat the Willie Mullins mare. But yeah, she's my selection, Honeysuckle. I think she just might have a little bit too much for Benny Deju. She's currently second favourite. So anybody that wants to have a go on Honeysuckle, you're getting a decent price here on a mare that's looked very good and improving throughout the season.
Yes, you're right. I mean, I know the race you want about her, Fairy House. I've watched a lot of races. Yeah, she made a mockery of that race. And I thought she was workmanlike against the colts in the Irish Champion Hurdle. But these horses can do no more than win when they're odds on favourites. And Honeysuckle does just that. I don't think she's ever lost a race in her life. So why would people not want to side with her? Ben, you mentioned the French import, Benny Deju. I mean, I'm on the French Gallop website a lot more than on the Irish racing website. And I think that horse has been aimed at Auteuil. You know, it won the French Champion Hurdle last year after Cheltenham. And I think the French seem to think that whenever they write an article about their French Champion Hurdle trials, they always mention the Willie Mullins horse in the articles. So that might be one for later on in the season. But like you say, it's a top-class mare, isn't it? That was unlucky last year. Had the race at its mercy last year when it unfortunately fell. But I can see why people think Honeysuckle is a good proposition. To me, it's not a race I've got any interest in this year, unfortunately. I was looking at one. The mare I have been following this year in this race has kind of let me down a bit, really, last couple of runs. that Oliver Sherwood trains Papagana. So I'm quite glad it's not running, really. I'd have backed it in the race if it turned up. But what about Stormy Island is one? I mean, I think that will try and lead all the way. It failed last year to do it. But it has, to me, I think, looked as though it could possibly have improved this year. But I do think the first two, the two you mentioned, I don't think they will give it enough rope, Stormy Island. But the way Stormy Island runs is she's always dangerous, I think, in races. Because she will, I think, go 20 lengths in front in this race. But to me, I'm just going to sit back and watch it and see what happens, sir. But for you, what do you think of Stormy Island?
Yeah, as you say, she's certainly a decent yardstick. And, you know, I remember a couple of years ago, she was disputing favouritism for the Triumph Hurdle. And as you say, she's really got one way of running, and that's out from the front and quickly. You know, she seems a little bit more settled than she was when she first came over. She used to be very headstrong, but I think they've got a little bit more relaxed now. But she'll still go, you know, a pretty strong gallop. But for me, the big two. But yeah, you know, they wouldn't want to be giving her a lot of rope because she is a useful mare herself. You know, you've got Roxana in here that's useful as well. But so it's a, as we said, Lady Buttons has had a good season too. This is a strong field, but I just feel that the big two mares are just that level above the others. And there might be a bit of cat and mouse here between the two of them. But you know, it'll be an exciting spectacle for sure. I don't think I've seen a mare's hurdle where, you know, probably since Quavega, Vola La Vedette, where we've had this kind of match race between two real good horses. But yeah, so I'm excited about this one. This is one of the races that I'm really looking forward to this week.
I tell you what, if they do get into these cat and mouse games and start looking at each other, the Stormy Island will be off. You know, I don't think they can afford to do that. But it's a fascinating race, like you say, and Honeysuckle to land the spoils this year for you, sir, yeah?
Yeah.
We are looking to do now is Double Handful, the horse racing podcast. You've obviously heard some of the audio, the articles are going quite well, but it's really just myself at the moment. So I am looking for a lot more help with the Double Handful side. We are always looking for other people to get involved with the Double Handful project. Really, we're looking at the moment for maybe article writers or co-hosts even. Basically, we'll just talk about racing, talk about anything that interests us in the racing sector. You can have your own voice, and you will be giving your own opinions live on air about the pastime you love. If that is something that interests you, then get in touch. The email address is info@reprievemediacic.epz.com. Say that once more, info@reprievemediacic.epz.com.
Exercise. It doesn't have to mean Lycra or a fancy gym membership. All you need is 10 minutes and you. Because a regular 10-minute brisk walk is a great way to get more active. Whether that's walking to the shops or getting off the bus to stop early. Picking up the pace and getting your heart pumping can make a real difference to your health. So, to see how much brisk walking you're doing and how you can fit more into your day, download the free Active 10 app. because there's only one you.
Do you like what you're listening to on Reprieve Media CIC? If you do, there are plenty of ways that you can support us as we continue. You can donate to the Reprieve Media CIC PayPal account. To do that, please head to our website, where you will see a donate tab on the side of the site. Also, Reprieve Media CIC is now on Patreon. Why not head over there now and check out our page? Just search for Reprieve Media CIC on Patreon. Thank you very much for your support, people. And you are listening to Reprieve Media CIC. Hello everybody, welcome back. That's the end of our day one coverage this year, really. We've not really got anything for the handicaps. We don't really like to get involved with them if we can avoid it. They are quite dangerous, the handicaps at Cheltenham. So we're just going to give a few selections what we fancy on the day. I mean, Steve, I'm more than happy to go first this year. I mean, my day really tomorrow revolves around one horse. That one horse is Shishkin. I will be hoping that can get me off to a good start. And then in the Arkle, them three I mentioned, Global Citizen, Rouge Vif, and the other one, Cashback. They really would be my only tentative selections. Always tentative at Cheltenham, but I would be, if the race wasn't a Cheltenham Festival race, it would be hard. Hard for me, based on pedigree and what I've seen with my own eyes, not to be confident with Shishkin, really. What about you, sir, for day one?
Day one selections, like you, Paul, in the Supreme Novices, obviously tough competitive race. I side with Shishkin. In the Arkle would be Notebook, although that'd be more of a hopeful selection rather than confident. In the Champion Hurdle, I'm obviously sticking with with Epitant once again. You know, last year was a disappointment, but I'm gonna give her another chance. She's a very good horse, and I think she'll go very close. And in, as mentioned, Honeysuckle is a pretty confident selection over Benny Deju. You know, many might disagree with that, but I'm pretty confident this mare's very, very good, and she will take all the beating.
So to clarify, my number one bet for the day would be Shishkin, and your number one bet of the day would be Honeysuckle, yes?
Yes, that's correct, Paul.
Fantastic, Steve. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for listening, and all the best.